And welcome to another episode of Mashable Pakistan Lab. Today we have with us the CEO of a local messaging app, TeloTalk, Mr. Shahbaz. Hello and welcome.
Hello, Fatima. Thank you so much for having me. Glad to be connected to you.
So I'll just dig right in. Before we discuss in detail TeloTalk and how it came about to be and all its technical aspects, just share a bit about yourself before starting TeloTalk. What have you been doing professionally, and was this the creation of this app sort of a progression that you saw yourself just getting into, or was it something that you had always planned to do something on the similar pattern and sort of things went your way?
Sure, Fatima. So basically, not only just me, but the entire core team, all of my co-founders, we have been in the Pakistani technology space for now the past 16 years. We started our journey back in 2004, which was an important year for Pakistan because that's where Telenor and Varit had just come into the market. So there was intense competition between all the telecom companies. What we used to do was basically connect Pakistani enterprises with Pakistani mobile users using SMS as a gateway service. So as you know, for 16 years, we have been in the messaging space all of our lives. So what we are seeing is actually a natural progression of what our skill set was and what our experience was going from a medium, which was now a sunset medium like SMS and IVR, and going into what a modern or contemporary medium is, which is OTT apps. So, user behavior has shifted from talking to each other using SMSs to now talking to each other using rich media on messaging applications. So that's basically what our experience has been at the moment.
So just share a bit about TeloTalk, like for our audiences, the name gives it away. To some extent, it is a messaging app. It's a local messaging app. And I was researching, so I found out that you guys, it is a lot more than just a messaging app. If you just look at the TeloTalk site, it has a lot of things, a lot of, communication tools related, but there is a lot of entertainment aspect to it, and there are a lot of other features as well. So just share how, when you founded TeloTalk, what was the progression like when you started out? Was the idea that all of these things will be a part of this product that you are creating, or was it like a stepwise progression? You started with a simple messaging app and then, went ahead with adding multiple features.
Absolutely, Fatima. I think that's a very important question. It's a question we asked ourselves a lot because creating another messaging app in this world, especially in a market where people are pretty much set in their ways, felt like a suicide mission. But we gave this particular plan of action a lot of thought. The reason why we did this is because, like I said, we have been in this industry for a long, long time. We have seen the users migrate from an old medium to now a newer medium as well. With a market like Pakistan, which came to the broadband space very, very late, we are seeing millions of new users coming online every day. The first thing that they do is they go to some kind of a social app, specifically a messaging app, right? And what we thought was there's opportunity here to build services on top of a social platform. Services such as banking services, services such as e-government services, or commerce services, etc. The idea was to then build services on top of a platform. It's difficult, or it's almost impossible, to execute that on platforms which are not Pakistani owned. The reason being because there are certain corporate governance issues, because all of these platforms are foreign owned platforms. They have no presence in Pakistan. They don't comply by local laws, rules, values. The other problem was there was local data compliance issues as well. So if you want to do sensitive services such as payments or e-commerce services, so it's very difficult to adhere to what the local laws demand you to execute if your data compliance isn't local either. So the third aspect of it was businesses. They need to have somebody to talk to, so for them to customize their services in order for them to interact with their customers. So when we saw that opportunity and we knew that it was going to be difficult to build all of these services on top of a platform that's not Pakistani, that's the point where we decided to take that plunge and decided to make a platform that Pakistanis everywhere could call home. The Telu talk, we also looked at regional success stories as well. This is the first time somebody is trying to execute this as a national messaging platform. The idea has been executed very well by WeChat, which obviously is not the best example considering they've got the great viral of China protecting it. But there's KakaoTalk out of South Korea, there's Zalo out of Vietnam, there's Line out of Japan, and now we've got ShareChat and Reliance Jio out of India, which is doing the exact same concept, which is basically executing a social layer on a national level, and then to build services on top. So that really was the germ of the idea on which we started to build TeleTalk on.
So just share what has the response been like, because this is something sort of a follow-up question from what you just said. You have mentioned, local app examples in other countries, but those countries are sort of, when it comes to the tech sector, they are pretty advanced. Even India is sort of way ahead from Pakistan as far as, the idea of tech, local tech industry is concerned. We are just in the budding phases, and we are just developing, the basics that from a layman's point of view, the other countries have sorted those issues out, and we are still working on those. So what has the response been to your app? Because as you already mentioned that, whenever somebody is sort of gets onto this a smartphone or on the broadband, the first thing from your research that you found out was that they, one of the main apps that they download is a messaging app. And from what I've seen recently is the fact that despite the fact that, for example, the WhatsApp fiasco that happened in the start of this year, everybody had issues, everybody had questions. Yes, we did memes as well, something that we're really good at. But people were still continue to use WhatsApp, even be it for personal use and specifically for business use in the local market. Because just baat mein aake, kafi logon ne Signal download kiya tha, bichara crash bhi kar diya unhone. But still, I don't think that the local market usage of WhatsApp has reduced in my viewpoint. So given that scenario, that environment, what has the response been to TeloTalk so far?
Gee, absolutely. I think that's a very important question to answer. Hamare liye dekhen, it's been a journey. When you start to build this system, the instinct is to build a P2P messaging platform. And so our whole idea was to hyper-localize it, to allow our people to talk to each other in their own languages. So hamare paas humne dekha ki, for example, on WhatsApp, log ek dusre ko sabse zyada voice notes bhej rahe hain. So we're like, why is that happening? And then we realized because they have no outlet to talk to each other in their own regional languages. So from day one, TeloTalk offers 6 Pakistani regional languages keyboards that you can talk to each other in your own languages. We also have our own customized stickers in which celebrate the uniqueness of being a Pakistani. Only a Pakistani knows what why aam khayega aam is a funny expression, right? So those kind of things and what we feel when India and Pakistan are playing cricket, the wo jazbaat hamare kya hote hain, only a Pakistani understands, right? So those are the kind of things we've tried to capture. More importantly, because we're on the ground, one of the things that we are very, very happy to see is not only people adopting the platform, but actually interacting with us. People are very vocal to talk about what they would like to see in the app, what they would not like to see in the app, or kis tarah unko apni, images ka flow chahiye, etc. Because we are there and we are there to respond back to them. They feel seen. There's a representation finally here that other platforms which are outside of Pakistan won't even care if a Pakistani writes an email to them, right? Mm-hmm. But for us, it's really building platform for the nation's youth, which is our core target demographic as well. So when we started this, after that, the product started to evolve as well. So from a bare bones messaging platform, it then became a much richer platform as well. For example, you must have observed in your own correspondences as well, you are having less and less conversations and doing more and more content sharing. Aapke either some kind of a news link or a video or a funny picture is coming onto your chats all the time as well. So what we did was we baked in the sources of all of these content straight into the messaging platform as well. So we've got a news section where you can go in and it's all local news sources. So you can read a Pashto newspaper, a Sindhi newspaper, or Urdu newspaper right into Teletalk, and you can share it instantly with people who are on Teletalk or even off Teletalk as well. So that need to actually consume content, to share content, is being addressed onto the system itself. So you don't need to have 10 different apps for you to, you know, utilize all of that as well. The other thing that it kind of ends up fulfilling is what we also saw, that people are really, really vocal or really enthusiastic about sharing content as well. So we gave them a space, which is a story space, in which all Teletalk users can actually upload stories that can be seen by all other Teletalk users, not just people who are on your contact list, but the entire community of Teletalkers can actually view, comment, share, follow on each other's content feeds as well. So those are the kind of things that we built in. So the next step for us really was to give them a communal space to talk to each other. So we've got chat rooms as well, in which without revealing your phone number, you can go in and talk to people who have like-minded interests. So people who are interested in cricket, who are interested in Islamic content, can actually find a communal area to go and chat with each other as well. So as you can see, it then evolved from just a messaging platform into a larger, robust, you know, social networking tool as well. So the response has been enthusiastic for us. We were able to amass about 1.5 million users, which in the larger context of things might not be much, but for us it's a huge victory, because if you still think about it, you don't see a lot of Teletalk advertising out there as well, because we are still trying to focus and build for the users.
Yeah, so as I mentioned earlier, this did actually come up as a sort of a striking factor, that it's not just a messaging app. The message board and everything sort of has a Reddit-ish aspect to it as well. And so, yeah, it's a social community building aspect, as you have explained. My next question would be something that you mentioned about offering multiple languages. It's interesting to see that, as you have mentioned, that you have found out that, you know, the reason a lot of people are using voice notes is because it's not just because of laziness for typing. It's because, you know, a lot of times local languages are not available. Urdu be most of us type Roman Urdu instead of, you know, actual Urdu script. So my question would be that before you share, you know, the technical difficulties that you faced, what were the linguistic difficulties? Because a lot of times we see this happening to Urdu, even in mainstream Urdu newspapers as well. If you open up, maybe our generation and the younger generation might not be able to point out, but I remember that, but the fact that my parents, when they open up an Urdu newspaper, they are very much able to highlight the fact that they're are linguistic, spelling, grammatical mistakes in a mainstream newspaper. Even you, at times they figure it out in one of the tickers that goes on on TV. So that is a huge problem. It's a huge problem which is sort of neglected a lot of times. It's happening in the mainstream media, so obviously it's being neglected. How did you go about to ensure that the regional languages that you are offering, they are linguistically strong, they are linguistically accurate?
It's very important for us, Fatma. It's still a work in progress, because the challenge that comes in is the target segment that we are trying to get on board first, who are our core demographic, 18 to 24-year-old Pakistanis, they have been brought up in a very multilingual environment. They hear different words than what we were brought up with, or what our parents were brought up with. They see words which look very different as well. SMS taught everybody to talk to each other in Romanized Urdu, so that kind of became a standard as well. Well, advertising messages are also going that way as well. So it becomes a challenge where you want to appear to be a platform that is also celebrating the uniqueness of our languages, but at the same time also wants to feel like your friend. So, for example, we still write users as users in Urdu font as well. We don't call them Sarafin, because we're not really an Urdu teaching app. But having said that, one of the things that we tried to improve upon was how Urdu looks in the digital medium. We haven't really evolved the Urdu font to appear nicer on platforms. If you look at even Google and you look at how Urdu looks like, it's the computer version of Urdu, right? So we use the Nastaliq font, which is what we have grown up looking into our newspapers, but we have grown up looking on posters out there as well, and which just looks beautiful when you're typing it and you're sharing with others as well. So those are the kind of things that we paid attention to. Another small thing that I would tell you is that we realize that you have challenges when you're typing in Urdu as well. So for example, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, type karna bahut difficult hai. So what we do is give hotkeys. So if you press that, you've got sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, pre-composed. You just click it and you send it. Similarly, innalillahi wa innalillahi rajiun. So those kind of things are already out there as well. So some of this is expressed in stickers, some of this is expressed into our hot keyboard as well. And it's a journey that we are on right now. We're trying to improve that day by day as well. One of the biggest technical challenges that comes in is because English reads left to right and Urdu reads right to left. So for that, your app changes every time you change the interface as well. So you literally have two versions of the same app onto your device as well to optimize for that. So those are the kind of challenges that we try to adhere to. But once again, we don't take that as a predicament. We actually take that as a feature improvement, which just makes the whole experience better.
So talking about challenges, just add a bit about as an organization, as a company, what were the difficulties, you know, from a business point of view, from the as you said, you know, recently, I think yesterday or day before yesterday, there was this news that, you know, Pakistan is in one of the lowest tiers when it comes to internet quality in the global index or something. So given this business and tech environment, what were the other difficulties or hurdles that you faced in developing Teletalk in Pakistan?
One of the biggest difficulties that any tech entrepreneur faces is to raise funds in order to fulfill your vision and dreams, right? And to fulfill them to the best of your abilities. So there's always a compromise because what you want and what you get, there's a trade-off over there as well. But these kind of platform plays require a lot of patience. So it's something that works well when the investors that come on board share that same vision and understand exactly what the challenges are going to be as well. Because tomorrow, while chatting with you, I'm able to transfer a picture to you, a location pin to you, I should be able to transfer money to you as well, right? So when you start to build those kind of platforms which are able to execute those kind of things, there are always integration challenges, there are always execution challenges as well. In a market that's just now budding, so whenever a quality investor or VC comes and joins hands with you, they're always building for the future. They're like, we don't care what the product is today, we're looking at what the market is going to be 5 years from now. So because Pakistan was so late to the broadband game, I think Afghanistan had 3G before Pakistan did, I think a good 2 years. So now that people are coming online for the first time, they will come with a very basic feature, you know, smartphone, which won't be able to keep a lot of apps on it. So technically, you have to consider them as well, because these are our core audiences as well. So what we try to do is make sure that the app is always lean. It's always able to execute on lower data signals as well. So those are the kind of things we do. But the volume is so attractive. 220 million people and about 100 million of them have just come online. So imagine what the total addressable market is rolling on to be as well. But once you start to build for even those which are available or have the means to enjoy your service, that volume already is attractive as well. But what it teaches you is efficiencies, wastage in terms of what your development prowess is going to be, what your capital spend is going to be. So that just becomes, you always have to keep an eye on that. So those are the kind of challenges that come aboard all the time.
Next, I think key aspect whenever we come to something like an app for Teletalk or just anything tech industry related, in general, I think around the world where now the conversation with each passing day is becoming focused on, you know, data security and how tech companies, you know, have been known from biggest names to, you know, be local companies as well have been found out to be misusing the data. So, and again, I will refer back to the WhatsApp fiasco that happened. Huge issue. So how does Teletalk work? What's the data security plan at your end? How do you plan to keep it secure, and specifically given in the Pakistani context? And I think this also comes in reference to the fact that for your audience, for the users, for your perspective users, this is now going to be a key question, because in Pakistan, we are not really confident when it comes to data security in any entity, from government entities to private entities, because from the simplest fact, specifically given the messaging app environment, if you look at it, we get so many these advertising messages. The way they are bombarded, everybody has this question at the back of their end: who is releasing our data? Telcos are doing it, banks are doing it. Where are these marketing agencies getting this bulk data? So what are the measures that you have taken to ensure or create confidence in your product?
Okay, I think that's you hit the nail on the head. It's something which is now a growing global concern. It's not just a Pakistani issue anymore. Especially what we witnessed in January as well, everybody was freaked out about how their data is being treated, right? There are two ways to look into this problem. One is the data that regulators are concerned about. It's how their citizens' data is being treated by big tech companies. The other is how the users perceive this as a problem as well. From a regulator point of view, this is a huge concern, because let's take an example. You've got a telco like Mobilink or Jazz, who has spent 20 years in Pakistan, spent billions of dollars in Pakistan, built a nationwide infrastructure network, franchise network, employed tens of thousands of people, spent on advertising dollars, and built a 60 million so strong audience to become the dominant communication service provider in Pakistan. Number two is WhatsApp, with about 30, 40 million subscribers. Which is insane, because there's no infrastructure development, no licensing, no job creation, no advertising, nothing has been spent by this third-party company that's got 40 million of Pakistanis on board, and all of their data is being monetized with nothing coming back and adding value into the community. So those are the kind of concerns that a regulator would be really concerned about. Okay, why is this happening? Why is my citizens' data being exploited? This isn't just Pakistan issue. We have seen Europe handle this as well with GDPR. They were concerned about how citizen data is being used by websites, being used by apps, being used by any third party tech company in order to be exploited. So there's this very closed approach which China takes, in which they're like, this is my citizen data. I'm going to protect it by building my own services, no outsiders. There's the Western approach, which just opens everything up. Now we're seeing this hybrid approach that Europe is taking as well. It's probably going to set the standards for others as well, because we are seeing India take the same kind of route too. Now, when we look at these kind of concerns cropping up, they have a multiplier effect when it goes into the audience as well. We saw that in January as well. The reason why it reverted back to status quo is the reason why, because they delayed their decision as well. I think there was a deadline, which was 15th of Jan, now it's moved to 15th of May. We don't know how that's going to happen. But see, that's a market factor issue. Teletalk's entire thesis was based on these concerns anyways. Okay, how will we build services on top of a platform that doesn't have data residency in Pakistan, that doesn't have data compliance in Pakistan? So that's why we started to build Teletalk, right? Because otherwise, we'll be waiting for somebody else to build for us, and then we build the services on top. So that's why we decided to take the plunge anyways. So that thesis got validated much quicker than we had anticipated. And what we were also surprised to see is how much of user concern there was, because we started to receive tons and tons of inquiries from our users who wanted to read our end user license agreement, who wanted to see what our terms and conditions are, how do we treat data. They were concerned about how we monetize data as well. So which we assured them that for us, we don't sell advertisement, we don't sell user data to upsell ads, but our whole business model is going to be from business to customer communication. So for example, your bank tomorrow would have a chat channel in Teletalk, and you'll be able to talk to them, and then we monetize through having the bank on board. Or similarly, your kids' school, similarly your hospitals, similarly your workplace, etc. So those are the kind of interactions is where we see that monetization will start to come in, besides the payment services, e-commerce services, and all the others as well. So in terms of you know, data security and data concerns, this is going to be a growing issue. It's going to have that multiplier effect. And I do perceive that more and more Pakistani companies are more and more, you know, national social media plays that start to get rolled out just in case to execute this, because right now there's no other choice. That's the reason why we return back to status quo. You probably haven't heard of any other messenger besides Teladoc in Pakistan. You must have heard of tons of ride-hailing companies or e-commerce companies or other tech startups, you know, or even B2B companies as well. But social media, nobody's really taken that seriously because it's so difficult to build, and you're competing with massive monolithic giants, you know, in that space as well. But it's just something that we feel passionate about, and it's just something that's going to be a standard for all nations to follow, in which, you know, national social media platforms are going to be the norm. So either the big tech is going to nationalize their platforms, which is unlikely, and even if it happens, they'll start with larger markets first, like Brazil, India, etc., before they come to Pakistan. So which is why we are there to address that exact concern and that need today.
You have like explained the, you know, the macro and the macro situation for Teladoc pretty well. I will wrap up with this last question that sort of you have touched upon in your last answer as well, where you have talked about the fact that you are trying to fill in that gap and for the local audience. But the thing is, how do you convince a local user, and specifically the demographic that you have shared, to switch from one of the apps that is globally being used to this local market? Because I see like two things come to mind. One is the fact that the macro issues that you have explained that are related to these apps that don't have sort of local investment, like WhatsApp doesn't have a local presence, and that stands true for any of the leading social media apps as well. But as a user isn't, honestly speaking, given specifically the demographic that you are targeting of the youth, not really invested in this idea of, you know, how using an app or using a product sort of has impact on the local economy or XYZ. They are more interested how they are connected with everybody else around the world, with their friends or family through an app. And these international apps sort of give them that sort of gateway. So does Teladoc have that that space where it can be internationally used? And secondly, the youth, how are you going to convince, as you also mentioned previously, that there's not a lot of advertising around this app. What's your plan to, you know, convince the local user to switch to this app?
So for that, Fatima, there are, once again, two perspectives at this particular issue. Is one to be of that one mind that we are going to switch a user from app A to our app, right? The other is to exist as a companion product. You'll have WhatsApp, you'll have Facebook, you have Instagram, you have Snapchat, you've got several other social platforms that exist within that are addressing some kind of a different need for you, right? So for us to be completely reliant on the fact that WhatsApp will have a data privacy issue and users will be educated, and that's where we are going to win, is going to be an unsustainable goal. So what we have done is, which is why you open up Teladoc today, it looks completely different from WhatsApp. That's for a specific reason, because we are building for what our users are responding to. So what areas is how it's different from WhatsApp are the ones which are resonating the most as well. So a lot of people have actually refined their entire contact list into a handful of ones that they love to contact on Teladoc, because they want to converse in Urdu, they would have these stickers they want to talk to. The other thing is the whole content consumption and sharing aspect of it. And the third one is to find new friends to talk to, which is not possible right now over there. So discovery process, and then, you know, to go into communities and talk to them, which are like-minded people, is something that connects. And it's just a differentiator for us as well. And those are the consumer product elements which are resonating with our users that we continue to refine and build for them as well. The other aspect of this entire discussion actually comes from the whole advertising angle of it as well. So we actually do. So a lot of advertising has now become so digital that instead of relying on billboards and, you know, larger campaigns, it becomes a lot more tactical for us to have a very specific sub-segment of, let's just say, rural youth or urban youth, that those are the pockets that we target and we convert onto our platform, and then we develop the cohort for. But at the same time, you know, we're also fundraising at the same moment to exactly hit the market hard. So those kind of roles are underway. We have successfully concluded an undisclosed round. So hopefully we'll be able to execute very, very soon, and you'll start to hear about Teletalk a lot more out there.
With this, I think we wrap it up. Thank you very much for your time. This was an interesting conversation, and best of luck, and hope to see you, that your organization and the product expands, and we get to see more interesting features from Teletalk. Until next time, thank you.